I will introduce an important type of emotion, which is called free fall, and it takes place on the surface of Earth. So, whenever you release an object on the surface of Earth, you know that it will fall down, okay? And it will fall down with a constant velocity, right? Will the velocity increases when the object is falling down, or it is constant? When you release the object, it will increase, it will fall down by increasing its velocity or speed, right? But the rate of increase of this velocity or speed is constant. That means it has a constant acceleration. Okay? Learn the concepts. Okay? So the rate of change of the velocity is constant, and this constant on the surface of Earth is known as the gravitational acceleration. It's a special kind of acceleration we have seen so far. It is the gravitational acceleration, and it is constant on the surface of Earth everywhere, almost. It has some discrepancy, for example, in the poles, on the north and south poles. This constant, it is known as G, it is written as G, 9.83, but on the equatorial region, it is 9.78. It is almost the same, but of course there is some difference. And why do you think that there is this kind of difference in G? Earth pulls objects, right, with the same force or acceleration everywhere if the Earth were not rotating, right? Because the rotation on the equatorial region, this acceleration is a little less. But on the poles, it is a little higher or larger than the equatorial region because of the centripetal acceleration. Anyway, we will take, during this course, G as 9.81. Unless otherwise stated, G is 9.8, and it is the constant gravitational acceleration. It does not depend on the mass of the object, right? Whenever you release two objects which have different sizes or masses, they will fall down with the same acceleration, right? Of course, there is always air friction, but if you release heavier objects like rocks or heavy ones, then you can ignore the air friction, okay? But there is always air friction. If you ignore the air friction, then the gravitational acceleration is the same for all objects. Regardless of their masses, they will have the same acceleration. So when you release a ball, as you see on this picture, from rest, when I say I release something from rest, that means its initial velocity is zero, okay? Whenever you see the word rest, from rest, it is the initial velocity is zero. So initially it is, it has no velocity, but after a while, instantly you release the object. For example, at t is equal to 1 second, the object will have exactly 9.81 meter per second, okay? After 2 seconds, the object will double this speed of 9.81. And at 3 seconds, it will be triple, and it goes like this, increasing its velocity. You see, this increase in the velocity is regular, and it is increasing in a linear fashion. But when you look the distance or the position of the object when it falls down at these 1, 2, and 3 seconds, you will notice that, for example, at t is equal to 1, the object falls 4.91 meters. At t is equal to 2 seconds, it is not the double of this value, right? It is larger than this. And at 3 seconds, it is not the triple of 4.91. So this is because x, the position, runs as a quadratic, right? As a t square, as the t runs, the x increases with t square, not t. Not a linear fashion like a velocity, but x is a function of t square, not t. Okay, in the constant accelerated motion. All right. So there is an important thing when you are dealing with the problems of the free fall. The first thing, you have to choose the direction of increasing x, okay, or y. It doesn't matter. Sometimes you see this as y, but it doesn't matter. The only matter thing is the motion is taking place only on line, the vertical line. If you choose your coordinate system, okay, your coordinate system, you choose a starting point for your object. For example, in here, the starting point or the origin is where you release the object. So it is zero. If you choose the downward direction as the increasing y or x, then your acceleration is plus g, okay? It is plus 9.81. But if you choose your increasing direction of y as upward, then your object, when you release, will go in the negative y direction, right? In this case, the acceleration you have to take as minus g, or minus 9.81, okay? So it depends on your choice. But whenever you fix the direction, then you will choose either plus or minus. You will go all the way down solving the problem with this sign. In the middle, you don't change the sign, okay? Whenever you choose your coordinate system, this determines the signature of your acceleration, and you will go with it. You don't change in the middle. All right. What you see is, remember I've shown the motion diagrams, the position versus time diagrams in previous lectures. This is the position versus time of a free fall, okay? But it's not a free fall, actually. Also, when you throw an object from ground or from an initial height upward, okay? You throw an object upward with an initial velocity, non-zero initial velocity, the object will go up, but this time it will decrease its velocity, right? Because acceleration is in the opposite direction. So at some point in the air, the object will stop eventually, right? Because the speed is always decreasing, or the velocity. So at some point, it will stop. This will be the maximum height of the object, and it will fall down back, okay, where you throw the object. So it will fall down back by increasing its speed, but the velocity still will decreases because the velocity will be in the opposite direction this time. So this plot shows this throwing an object from a ground or from a certain position up in the air. As you see, when the object, as time passes in the horizontal direction, the object is traveling up by taking some distance, but this is somehow decreasing. At some point, at a maximum point in here, the object will no move further away from the origin. It will stop and it will fall back to the same position. This point and this point are the same position. Okay? For example, object from this point passes by a speed of or velocity of 19.6 meter per second. And after some while, after some, this is first second, and this is fifth second, after 4 seconds later, the object will pass through the same point, but exactly with the negative of the velocity, minus 19.6. So what you see is this curve is nothing but a parabola, right? Because the object has this expression, x is equal to x0 plus v0 times t plus or minus 1/2 g t square. What is plus or minus? Should I put plus or minus in here? I should put minus because as time passes, there is a decrease in the velocity and also decrease in the x direction. So I should put this minus 1/2 gt square. And you can always take as the origin 0. So x will be v0 times t minus 1/2 gt square. This is the equation of a parabola, right, in time. So that's why we have this curve. Okay, so let's do an example. A swimmer jumps from a platform down with a non-zero, with a zero initial velocity, okay? So, in this problem, we have chosen the increasing position, increasing x direction as downward. So, this means I have to take the acceleration as plus, because the acceleration is always down. It is always down if the both arrows, the acceleration and the position shows the same direction, that means A will be plus. So the question is, it jumps 3 meters. After 3 meters, what is the time that the swimmer hits the surface of water? Also, what is its velocity, impact velocity? So you can easily find the impact velocity by using this expression, because the speed or the velocity is increasing linearly with g times ts. But what is ts? Time of flight. You can find time by using the position expression. And after time of flight, it will hit the surface of water, and this is where x is equal to h. It's height, initial height, right? And you can always take x0 as 0, and since its initial velocity is 0 also, h will be equal to 1/2 gt square, and you know everything, h is equal to 3, g is 9.8, so you can solve for t, and t will be, I don't know, if you have a calculator, you can do this immediately, 2 times 3 is 6 divided by 9.8, and this will be in square root. And you can put this expression into the velocity. You know g, you know ts is just the square root of this 2 times h divided by g, and the velocity will be in square root 2g times h. And again, you can calculate this, 2 times 9.81 times 3, and everything is in square root. It will be in meter per second. So, one thing you should be careful in these type of questions, first choose your coordinate system, and determine the sign of acceleration. Another example, a volcano, the opening of a volcano throws a stone up in the air with some initial velocity, not a non-zero velocity, initial velocity, not a zero velocity, but it has some initial velocity. And the object, the stone, the lava rock, fires from the opening with some initial velocity, and it come back to the same position after time t is equal to 4.75 seconds. The question is, what is its initial velocity? Can you find its initial velocity with this information only? So again, before starting to solve the problem, just put up a coordinate system. We have chosen this coordinate system this time. Remember, acceleration is always down. But since the increasing x direction is up, then the acceleration should be taken as minus g. And then you can easily find an expression for v0, because, you can use either the position expression when the rock comes to the same position where it started, and if you take this starting position as the origin, then the final position will be zero. Also, the initial position will be zero, and you can solve the rest for v0, right? If you put zero and zero in this equation, you will end up with this v0 times t, 1 half gt square, and you can easily solve for v0 in terms of g and t. But t is already given, 4.75, and you know what the g is, you can easily find it. This is initial velocity. The problem also asks you the final velocity, because the rock comes back to the same position with a velocity which is the opposite to the initial velocity. But as you guess, this velocity have the same magnitude, right? But only the direction is changing. So because the motion is symmetric around time. So again, if you are using this v expression, the velocity expression, see, we can use a different expression to find the final velocity, different than position, and the velocity is always v0 minus or plus g times t. In this case, it is minus. So you know v0, and you know time of flight, tr. If you put this, you can find the final velocity as minus gtr divided by 2, which is the minus of its initial velocity. Okay, if you don't have any questions, we can go further. We have another example. This may look like a little complicated to you. This time, an object is thrown on top of a building, but it's in the upward direction. These type of questions, I recommend you that to choose the initial position of the object as the origin of your coordinate system. So this time, you can choose this point where the ball is thrown on top of the building as the origin. And you can choose again the upward direction as your increasing direction of y. So with this choice, your a will be minus g. And everything is given in the problem. The initial velocity is given, v0. It is 20 meters per second. And the height of the building is given, or the height of the object or ball which is thrown from the ground is given as 50 meters. By the way, can you see the numbers? It is hard to see, so let me write it down here. This is 50 meters. And the question is, when the ball go up to the maximum height, maximum position, what is the time? What is the time it takes to go up at the maximum position? So for this, you can easily use the velocity formula, okay? Because you know that at the maximum position, the V will be zero, right? The velocity will be zero. This final velocity is zero at top. And you know initial velocity. Initial velocity is given in the problem. It is 20 meters per second. So you can solve for T. T is just V zero divided by G. And this is 2.04 seconds. So when you throw the object up in the air, it goes to the maximum position after T is equal to 2.04 seconds. Also, what is the maximum height? The problem says, what is the maximum height? You can easily use the position expression for this. Since we have taken the initial position as the zero, so y0 is equal to zero in here, you don't need to use y0. The rest of the expression is v0 times t max minus 1/2 g t square max. And by using the previous expression, you can easily find this maximum position as 20.4 meters. But this is the distance or the position measured from here, okay? From the point where you throw the object. If you ask this maximum position from the ground, then just you will add 50 meters. And the rest is what is the time of flight when y is equal to minus 50 meters. Again, you will use the expression for position. This time your final position will be minus 50 meters. Here, although I have put this 50 meters in this initial height of the object, I choose as the final position of the object as minus 50. Because I have chosen the initial position of the object as the zero. So from this down to the ground is minus 50. Okay? This also is important, and you may easily confuse in the problems. You may easily put plus 50 meters, but be careful in here. Okay? So you can look at this. I will put on the lecture notes at home again. So this completes the motion in one dimension, the chapter 2. And from this, we will analyze the motion in two dimensions. Okay? In analyzing motion in two dimensions, we need some mathematical concepts, which is called vectors. I will introduce you what the vectors are in chapter 3, and then we will analyze the motion in two dimensions, because without using the concept of vectors, we cannot analyze the motion in two dimensions. So in physics, there are some quantities, physical quantities, that we need some extra information, okay? For example, when I'm talking to you that I'm going with a 10 meter per second velocity, the next question you will ask, okay, in which direction are you going, right? I can give you the magnitude of my velocity, but the direction also is important in physics. Or you can say somebody is pulling you with a force of 10 newtons. So the next question is, in which direction? In physics, if you have a physical quantity where some directional information also is needed, then we call these kind of physical quantities as vectors, okay? But there are always other physical quantities where there is no need for direction. For example, temperature. Today, the weather is 25 degrees Celsius. So there is no need for any direction or nothing. It's just a scalar. Or the mass of an object. It's a scalar, okay? The mass is the number of atoms or whatever quantities in an object. So it does not have any directional information. So there are always some physical quantities. Only a number is enough. Or there are some physical quantities. A number together with some directional information is also important. Okay? So there are scalar quantities and there are vectorial quantities. Vectorial quantities are position, velocity, acceleration, force, okay, momentum, you will see, angular momentum, torque. These are vectorial quantities, but scalar quantities like temperature, mass, speed is a scalar quantity, okay, because I said speed is always a positive quantity and it may be zero, but it can never be negative. And in your car, the speedometer always show the speed, not the direction of your speed, right? You can go in any direction, the speedometer will always give you some number, that's it. Alright, so I think you can appreciate that why do we need vectors in physics is important. So before we analyze vectors, first I have to introduce a coordinate system in physics, okay? Without using a coordinate system, talking about vectors doesn't make any sense, okay? A vector in physics or in math, we denote an arrow, straight arrow, with some length and some direction. That's it. This blue line represents a vector. And this vector, as you see, has a direction, right? Its direction is already there. If you put your coordinate system, y and x like this, it has a direction, and this direction makes an angle 25 degrees with the x-axis, okay? And also, the length of this vector is given. This is a position vector, and it is given by 1.5 meters. So, as you see, there are two numbers in here. One is the magnitude of the vector. This time, our vector is a position vector, and its magnitude is distance, and it is 1.5. And its direction. Direction means this angle. If you know this angle, you certainly know the direction, okay? You certainly know the direction of the vector. So as you see, it is always enough to give only two numbers to characterize or to uniquely set up a vector. Well, the vectors may be represented in two different ways, okay? What I was talking about is the polar representation of a vector, because I have given you the magnitude of the vector and its angle, but I may well express the same vector with its components, okay? The y component I may have given and the x component. These two components also are enough to characterize or to uniquely determine a vector. And this is the Cartesian representation of a vector. This is the polar representation of the vector, and this is the Cartesian, okay? In Cartesian representation, we are dealing with the components of the vector in x and y directions. Of course, if you are describing a vector in three dimensions, also there is an extra dimension, z. There is z direction, y, and x direction. But for the simplicity, we will only deal with two dimensions in this chapter. three dimension is just a generalization. Okay. In Cartesian coordinate system, the components of a vector may be a negative quantity. Okay. These quantities may be negative. Okay. If, for example, I have drawn you a vector in this direction, okay, it's another vector, and this vector with this choice of coordinate system, origin is here, certainly has a negative x component, right? Because when you project this onto x-axis, this is on the negative x-axis, right? So it has a negative Rx, but while its coordinate in the y direction or y component is positive still. So in Cartesian coordinate system, the components may be both negative or positive, but the same is not true for polar coordinate system. For polar coordinate system, the magnitude is always a positive quantity. You may not have a negative quantity in polar representation. Okay? And the angle, theta, cannot be infinitely large. Okay? Although the magnitude can be infinitely large, the angle is bounded, right? The angle may be a number between 0 or 360 degrees. If you give an angle which is larger than 360, you end up with the same position. Okay? This is 25 degrees, this angle. Well, you may well say that this angle is not 25, but 360 plus 25. That means 385 degrees. But this time, you see, there are two different numbers showing the same direction. Okay? So, to avoid this, we only limit the angle between 0 and 360. And this is in terms of degrees. Also, we use a different unit system for angles. It's the radian. The angle also can be a number between 0 and 2 pi. Okay? If you are talking about the angles in terms of radians, then you can use this. And pi is a number 3.14, right? Okay, that's enough for representing vectors in a coordinate system. Should I give a break or continue? Okay, let's give a break 10 minutes and then we will continue. Ödevleri arkadaşlar, ödevleri getirebilirsiniz.
Fatih Furkan Erol, benim de o hocam. Şeyi falan hocam, hani ben şey yapamadım, silemedim. Sadece Fatih Furkan, Altıra Erol, Etutmay, o kalacak. Hani diğerlerini silemedim.
Tamam, o zaman hocam, benim de iki tane var orada sanırım. Bir tanesini kaydoldum.